I am Anil Kumar. Welcome to my YouTube channel and the website Global Math Institute. Let me thank all the viewers and subscribers for watching my videos, taking keen interest, and especially those who are working from home and sending their request on our email. While you can also join the WhatsApp group, which I especially created for such occasions, we have excellent team who is working on your questions and providing excellent solutions. So join the WhatsApp group. You can also look into the updates on our website, the Global Math Institute, and in case of urgency, you can provide questions to me directly and I can provide the solutions. However, the most recommended here is to join the WhatsApp group. We'll now talk about domain and range of functions. I hope you watched the part one of this particular video where we introduce you the domain and range. Let's now continue with the concepts learned. So in the very first part, we'll actually go through what we have learned in part one. So we will have a quick review with an example and then look into special cases. We'll talk about restricted domain conditions, word problems, strategies to identify asymptotes. Now that's a huge chapter. So I'll also introduce you to rational functions and then talk about horizontal and vertical asymptotes to find domain and range. We'll take up practical examples for piecewise functions. We'll see how to find domain and range for a quadratic function, especially by using completing the squares method when we are given equation in standard form. Then we'll support the transform functions with few examples. This is very critical from test point of view. Now that is a communication question, how to sketch a graph from the given domain and range. So kind of reverse calculation followed by some thinking and application questions from previous test papers, and then we'll summarize. So this video will be more than half an hour long, so have patience and understand all the concepts. You can actually pause in between to solve questions yourself. So let's begin with the overview of part one. So here I have two graphs. I want you to write domain and range for the following functions, right? So write domain and range for following functions. Here we have figure one, and then here we have figure two. Okay, so let's begin with the very first one. You can see that there are two restrictions on the domain. These are at x equals to minus one and plus one. So we have vertical asymptotes. At x equals to plus 1 and minus 1, they are going to restrict your domain. So for figure 1, the domain can be written as domain is x belongs to real numbers. However, x is not equal to plus minus 1. Clear? Now, how about range? As far as range is concerned, you can see that the center portion actually continues throughout. So we can safely write down that the range of this particular function is y belongs to real numbers where there is no restriction. So let's just close it. You get an idea, right? Now in figure two, there are a couple of things which I like you to focus on. One of them is the dark circles here, that means included. Right, and here we'll think as if it is continued, and this position here is an open circle. Otherwise, this is not a function. So for a function at a value of x, we can only have one value of y, correct? It makes sense. And therefore, that is open circle, that is a closed circle, value included, value not included. Keeping that in mind, I like you to write domain and range of this particular function, and then check with my solution. Well, the domain here is that x belongs to real numbers and x is from this point onwards to the right, it continues, right? Here also we have a value at x equals to 2. And therefore, we can write this as x is greater than equal to minus 1. So that becomes the domain for the given function. How about the range? Now, range will be all the y values. So y does belong to real numbers. The restriction is that it is between this value, which is minus 2, to 4. But 4 is not included. So we should write this as between minus 2, right? Minus 2 is included, but 4 is not included. So don't write equal to, less than 4. So that becomes the range. So this value, which is 4, is actually not included. This means not included. So with that, we learn most of the concepts which we had been talking about. And I think you're ready to go through this video now. Next question here is based on restricted conditions. Question 2 is, determine range of the function f of x equals to 2x squared minus 4x minus 1 if domain is x belongs to natural numbers and x is greater than 1, less than 5. I'd like you to pause the video, answer this question, and then look into my suggestions. So, when I say that x belongs to natural numbers, right, and I'm saying that x is between 1 and 5, that means what values of x we are talking about? Can you tell me this part? Fill in this. Does it include 1? No. The only values of x could be 2, 3, and 4, not 1 and 5. Look at the sign carefully. So that is, sometimes that could be a mistake. It is not equal to. Perfect. So that becomes the domain for the given function, and we can now calculate range for these values. That is to say, calculate the value f of 2, calculate the value f of 3, and f of 4. So these are the three values which will be there for the range of the function. So let's substitute these values here for x, right? So this value of x will be substituted with these values. Does it make sense to you, right? So let's do it. So what we get here is 2 and 2 squared minus 4 times 2. So I've substituted 2 in the equation, which is 2x squared minus 4x minus 1. So minus 1. So that gives you 2 squared is 4. 4 times 2 is 8. So we get 8 minus 8 minus 1. That is minus 1. The next one is 2, 3 squared minus 4 times 3 minus 1. 9 times 2 is 18. 4 times 3 is 12 minus 1. 6 minus 1 is 5. And then we have 2, 4 squared minus 4 times 4. Minus 1 equals to 32 minus 16 minus 1. 16 minus 1 gives me 15. And therefore, the range can be written as these three values, which are minus 1, 5, and 15. Is that clear? Perfect. Let's move on. Question number 3 is, find the restriction to the range of relation x squared plus y squared equals to 4 to be a function. What? So we are given a relation. We want to make it a function. Right. So I hope you get it now. So what we are talking about is something like this. X squared plus y squared equals to 4 is basically a circle, right? Now circle is not a function. It is definitely a relation, but not a function, simply because for any value in between, we have two values of y. So it is not a function. So we have a relation, which is not a function in this case. Simply because it failed vertical line test. That's a quick reminder of our unit 1 beginning, right? Introduction. Now the question here is, how can I restrict the range to make it a function? Does it make sense to you? Well, one way could be, I only consider the upper half. And that means I'm going to restrict the range. So the restriction could be like this. So we have a restriction here, which could be, we could have only y values, which are positives. That could be a restriction. Does it make sense to you? This is the key to answer this particular question. And therefore, we will write, now we understand, restriction to the range. So we can say, now y belongs to real numbers where y is greater than or equal to 0. So if I do this restriction, in that case, we're talking about the semicircle. Perfect, which is a function. So that becomes the answer for you. Is that clear? Perfect. Let's move on and take up the next question. Now, these are real test questions which you find in test papers. So if you are spending some time in understanding these concepts, it is worthwhile. Question number 4 here is, the height h of t of the ball in meters after t seconds thrown from a building is modeled by the equation. Here is the equation for you, which is h of t equals to minus 5 t minus 2 whole square plus 45. Find its domain and range. You can now pause the video, answer the question, and can look into my suggestions. Now, before getting into the details, let me sketch the scenario here and then we'll continue with the solution. It seems that our ball is being thrown, so from some height, so ball will definitely go up and then come down, right? So that is the path which it is going to take. Now, since the equation is this, let me rewrite this equation here. We are saying h of t equals to minus 5 t minus 2 whole square plus 45. That basically means it does reach a maximum height of 45 when t equals to 2 seconds, right? So this is time in seconds, and here we're talking about height in meters. Is that clear to you? So we do have a maximum height, and from maximum height, we have the range, right? So we can definitely write down the range part. Let's at least write range. So I'll say range is the value of h of t, which is the height, right? So height. So height belongs to real numbers where height is between 0 and 45. Is that clear? So we know the range. How do we find the domain? Now, domain in this case is the t values, which are from 0 to the time when the ball hits the ground. We have to find this particular time. So at this point, height is 0. So if I write 0 for the height, then I'm in a position to find the time. So I'll write 0 for the height. And we have minus 5 t minus 2 whole square plus 45. Solve the equation. Bring this term here. We get 5 times t minus 2 whole square equals to 45. Divide by 5. So we get t minus 2 whole square equals to 45 divided by 5, which is 9. Well, with square root, then we have t minus 2 equals to square root of 9. Now, square root of 9, well, you could write plus and minus, will give you plus and minus 3. However, in this particular situation, minus has no meaning, since we know that in this equation, t has to be greater than equal to 0, right? Okay, so when you want to calculate this value, you'll say t will be equals to 2 plus minus 3. And that gives you two answers. If you use the plus value, you get 5, and the minus value, minus 1. Now, minus 1 is not a valid answer, right? This is not valid. So, only valid answer is 5. So, we know this point here is t equals to 5. Now, can you write down the domain of the function? We already have the range. So, let me highlight the range part, which is right there. And now, write down the domain for the function. So, the domain is from 0 to 5. Let me write down here. Domain is from 0 to 5, right? So, I've written it in short. That is also a valid way of writing, and it is called interval notation. Perfect. So, that becomes the domain for you. So, that is part of our answer. So, our answer here is 1, domain is from 0 to 5. The other one, the range, is from 0 to 45. Perfect. Let's take up the next example, which is question number 5. A rectangle has perimeter of 100 centimeters. Find domain and range of its area, right? So we want to find domain and range of its area. So let's consider a rectangle first. So in a rectangle, we can write down the dimensions as length and width. Let's say this is length and that is the width. So we are given that the perimeter is 100. That means 100 should be equal to twice length plus width. Clear? That means 50 equals to length plus width. Or we can write 50 minus W equals to length. So we get length in terms of width. Now that really helps because now we can find area in terms of one variable. We know area is equal to length times width. Now we are saying that the area should be length is 50 minus W. So we'll write this as 50 minus W times W. So that becomes the area. So now area has been written as a function of W, right? So we have area as a function of W. Right? Let me write down. So we have area as a function of width, W. So we can now write domain and range. What could be the values of W? Yes. So what could be the values of W? Now see here. W cannot be more than 50. Otherwise, this will be negative, right? So we get the domain here, and the domain here is that the value of W belongs to real numbers. However, it should be between 0 and 50. Otherwise, this portion will be negative, right? So let me highlight. We got this condition from here. Perfect. Now, how do you get range? So, a couple of ways to get range. One is, some of you know that square gives you the maximum area, right? So, let me write down the key thing here to remember, which is square provides maximum area for same perimeter. Correct? So, if known, you could do it. Otherwise, we can find maximum from the equation which is right before us. So, what we are going to do now is kind of sketch this. It is easy to understand with the help of a sketch. So you can see it is kind of like this, where A and width W and this point will be 0, and that is going to be 50 for us, correct? Why? W 0 and this W 50 are the two x-intercepts for the area. So right in the center, which is 25, will get the value, maximum value of A. So the range is the value of this function for W equals to 0 and for W equals to 25. Perfect. So that is how you're going to get the range. So let me do the calculation now. So we get for range is from, let's do calculation here, A value when W is 25. 50 minus 25 times 25 is 625. Perfect. 25 squared. And that gives us a way to find the range. And now I'll write down the range. So the range is that the area belongs to real numbers where it is between 0 and 625. Is that clear to you? 625. So that becomes the range. So let me rewrite here. So range is between 0 and 625. Perfect. So that's how we are going to do it. So let me take another example here. Now this one, it is rational functions overview before we get into details of rational functions. Now, rational functions is a chapter in itself, but I'll cover it in short. Rational functions normally can be written as a ratio of two polynomials. We'll write it as numerator over denominator. Is that clear to you? And clearly, denominator d of x should not be equal to 0. But if it is 0, that leads to restrictions. Is that clear to you? Right? Now, this 0 can give you two conditions. One of them is a whole, and the other one is a vertical asymptote. And both these are restrictions for what? They restrict domain. Is that clear to you? So if we have to find restriction on the domain, equate denominator to 0. That gives you restrictions on domain. Is that clear to you? Now, let's talk about restrictions on range. So as far as the range is concerned, we are looking for horizontal asymptotes. I'm giving you a shortcut here. Let us say that the degree of numerator is n and degree of denominator is m. In that case, we have three conditions. The three conditions are that either n is less than m, let's start with this, right? Or n is equal to m, or n is greater than m. These could be three conditions, right? So we call them as our cases. We say this is a case 1, case 2, and case 3. Now, depending on these three cases, we have our results. So if numerator degree is lower than the denominator, then we have a horizontal asymptote, and the equation is y equals to 0. If the degrees are same, we do have a horizontal asymptote, which is y equals to leading coefficient of the numerator divided by leading coefficient of denominator. We'll touch base on this in the coming video slide. But if n is greater than this, then we do not have no asymptote, no horizontal asymptote. So means no restriction. Is that clear to you? So if the degree of numerator is higher, then we have no restriction at all on the range, right? For example, Let me take up a simple example. If I have 1 over x, that means horizontal asymptote is y equals to 0. The degree of denominator, which is 1, is higher than that of numerator. So that is your case 1. Is that clear to you? So this is your case 1. Now the second case is same degrees. If I have 2x plus 1 over 3x minus 1, in this case, horizontal asymptote will be 2 over 3. That means the ratio of leading coefficients. Does it make sense to you? 2 over 3. But if I have the third condition, which is if I have 2x squared minus 1 over x plus 1, that means range is all real numbers. No restriction. Perfect. So let's take these cases with examples, and then we'll understand the whole concept. So you can now pause the video, answer this question. We'll apply the strategy learn to solve this in no time. Tips to write. So tips, that is kind of important, to write horizontal asymptote from the equation. So we'll just focus on horizontal asymptote for the time being. So, and then we'll look into vertical also. So here, what is n equals to? Degree of numerator is 2. Degree of denominator, m, is 3. So clearly, we have a condition when m is greater than n, and therefore, we have a horizontal asymptote, which is y equals to 0. Is that clear to you? Let me write down the second equation. Numerator degree is 2. Denominator degree is also 2. Do you see this 2 here? And therefore, we have their degrees equal. We have an horizontal asymptote, which is y equals to the ratio 3 over 2. Ratio of the leading coefficients, which are these. Now, the third example here is numerator degree is 3, denominator degree is 2. Since numerator is greater than denominator degree, we have no horizontal asymptote. So range is y belongs to real number. There is no restriction at all. Is that clear to you? Perfect. Now, as an added exercise, what you can also find here is you can write down what is the domain of the functions. So for domain, you have to look into the denominator. So now focus on denominator for domain. All the three cases, right? So in this case, we know x is not equal to minus 1. X cube will become minus 1 when x is 1. And in this case, 2x squared minus 8, we know x is not equal to what? 8 divided by 2 is 4, and square root means plus minus 2. And here it is always positive, so x belongs to real numbers, no restriction, right? This is always a positive number, so no restriction. Does it make sense to you? So accordingly, you can now write down the domain based on the condition which I've just worked. But take this as an assignment. To write domain and range. Is that clear? Perfect. So let's take up next question, which is for us question number 9. We are now talking about piecewise functions, right? So piecewise functions. So piecewise functions means that there is not just one function, it's combination of more than one. Question number 8 is, postal rate in Canada for standard size mail are as follows. From 0 to 30 grams, it is $1.07. For 30 to 50 grams, it is $1.30. And from 50 to 100 grams, it is $1.94. Write down domain and range for the postal cards. Okay, charges. So in this case, what do you think is the domain and what do you think is the range? So in this case, mass is the domain part, right? And the amount or charges is the range part. Clear? how much you pay. So from here, domain is clearly 0 to 30, 30 to 50, and 50 to 100. So clearly, domain is, you can say, mass M between 0 to 100. Now, what should be included and what should not be included? Well, if it is 0, that means you don't have to pay. Will you pay a dollar for 0 grams? I don't think so. So that will not be included, but this will be included. Does make sense to you? Now, as far as the range is concerned, range could be 1.07 or 1.30 or 1.94. So only three elements are there in the range which are given here. So the critical part here is to remember that this is not equal to, but this is less than, greater than an equal to, right? So that is kind of critical. So now let's see what is next for us. So here we have another piecewise function. I'd like you to pause the video, look into this piecewise function, and then figure out what is domain and what is range. Question number 9 is, write down domain and range of the following piecewise function. So f of x is 0 for x is less than 1. F of x is x for x between 1 and 10, and it is 0.1 x squared for x between 10 and 12. You can now pause the video, answer this question, and then look into my suggestions. Now, I'll prefer to actually sketch this and then write down domain and range for the function. Now, one part is very clear to me, which is the first part, which is for x less than 1, it is 0. That means kind of like this, right? If this part is 1, it doesn't make sense. Let me use another color for the second one, which is, it is a straight line when x is from 1 to 10. So 1 to 10 means kind of like this, right? It is a straight line. Let me make a straight line now. Okay, so this point is 1, and this point will be 10. 1 to 10. And the third part to this is this function, which is 0.1 x squared from 10 to 12. So let's find the value of the function at 10. So if I substitute 10 here, I get 0.1 times 10 squared, which is 100 times 0.1, which is 10. And then let's also find what is f of 12 equals to. 0.1 times 12 squared, which is 14.4, right? 144 and one decimal. So we get a point here, of course, and then it's like a parabola, so it'll be somewhere here. So this point will be 14.4, and this point here will be 12, and that is 10. Does make sense to you? Now, can you write down domain and range? It's simpler. Okay, take your time. Most important part which I want to now focus on is a common mistake. Remember these signs? They do not include the number, and that critically means that these are open circles. These are all open circles. They are not closed circles. Now you can write down domain and range for the function. So let's write down domain first. So domain is x belongs to real numbers where x is from, you can say, less than 12, right? Less than 12. And x is not equal to 10 and 1. You can say 1 and 10. Since we already written x less than 12, you know, that is perfectly fine. And as far as the range is concerned, what is the range now? Well, the range is y belongs to real numbers. So this part and then 0. So it could be y equals to 0 or y is between 1 and 10 or y is between 10 to 14.4. So you have to write them separately for getting it correct. Does it make sense to you? Very important question, and normally in test paper, you might just do a mistake. Now here we have another interesting question. Complete squares for quadratic range. Find domain range for the quadratic function, and we're talking about the function which is f of x equals to 2x squared minus 4x minus 1. The equation is given to you in standard form. When equation is given in standard form, how do you find the vertex? So that means we have to convert this to vertex form. Once you know the vertex, then you can write range. As far as the domain is concerned, is given to you. Do you see that? Domain is, let's write down. Domain of the function is x belongs to real numbers where x is greater than 0, right? So you can write like this. Only positive numbers they are taking, including 0. Now, let's do completing the squares to find the range. So we are given the function f of x equals to 2x squared minus 4x minus 1. You'll take 2 common. We get x squared minus 2x. We'll keep this one outside. Add and subtract half of 2, which is 1 square and minus 1 square. And that makes it a perfect square, x minus 1 whole square. And that is minus 1 minus 1. Open the bracket. 2 times x minus 1 whole square minus 2 minus 1. Is that clear to you? You may have to review factoring skills and completing the squares, the quadratic functions which you read earlier, right? That is important. Now here, we will rewrite this function f of x as equals to 2 times x minus 1 whole square minus 3. So that means we have a parabola which really opens upwards, right? So we have a parabola which opens upwards like this, and we know this vertex. And therefore, we can now write down the range of the function. So we can say range is, now, it is also important to see that the x value is greater than 0. So we have to put in x 0 and then check the range. If I put x equals to 0, this point here at present is 1 and minus 3. So 1 is not valid. It is slightly on the right side. Does it make sense to you? So let's write f of 0 equals to 2 times minus 1 whole square minus 3, which is 2 minus 3 or minus 1. And therefore, minus 3 is not the right value. Perfect. X is greater than means we are actually talking about the x values from here onwards. Minus 3 is not in the domain mentioned. Perfect. And therefore, the range is y belongs to real numbers, so that y is greater than equal to minus 1, not minus 3. If you write minus 3, your answer will be incorrect. Does it make sense to you? That is how the questions are framed, so that you just make a mistake and you have to be very careful. Now let's look into more questions. Now we'll talk about transformed functions and how do we find domain and range of these functions. Couple of ways. One is, this is question number 11. Let me rewrite and give you a trick here. We have y equals to square root of 5x plus 2 plus 3. We know the function is going upwards, kind of like this. So we need to find what is the x values. So within the square root, we know 5x plus 2 should be greater than equal to 0. Solve this inequality. Is that clear to you? And get your answer for domain, right? So which is minus 2 divided by 5. And so we have our answer, which is domain is x belongs to real numbers, where x is greater than equals to minus 2 over 5. And as far as range is concerned, range will be dependent on this value 3. and it is moving upwards. So y belongs to real numbers where y is greater than or equal to 3. Is that clear? That is the easiest way of writing solutions. Let us practice with one more example. This time, the function is y equals to 5 minus square root of minus x plus 2. Now, this minus here means what? This minus means what? This minus means reflection on x-axis. Correct? So that means less than, we're talking about less than 5, less than or equal to, right? Or equal to 5. Clear? So we know that the range in this case is y belongs to real numbers where y is less than or equal to 5. So we got the range. Now to get the domain, we look into the inside part and we have here minus x plus 2 should be greater than or equal to 0. It has to be non-negative. This is negative. Give it to the other side. So it'll be like this. So we know the domain, and that is x belongs to real numbers such that x is 2 is greater than x means x is less than or equal to 2. So this is the easiest way of answering the transformed square root functions. Now here are some more. Okay, question 13 is, given function f of x with domain. So we are given the domain now, with domain this and the range as that. Find domain and range of g of x, which is a transformed function, kind of like this. If f of x is always decreasing, it's coming down. Okay, so that means there are no turning points in between. And so we can work with the end points. So we know that now g of x is given to us as 5 times f of 3 x minus 2 minus 1. So the portion which works on the domain is inside. So let's work on domain first. So what is happening to domain? Divide by 3, add 2, right? So we have here minus 12. We'll divide this. This is for, let me rewrite. So that is a domain, correct? So when we do for g of x, in that case, we have to do minus 12 divide by 3 and then add 2, right? This is for g of x. So 24 divided by 3 plus 2. When you divide this, you get minus 4. Minus 4 plus 2 is minus 2 of g of x. 24 divided by 3 is 8. 8 plus 2 is 10. And that becomes your answer. Is that clear to you? So I'm showing you the trick here. And now let's talk about the range. Let's change the color. The range is minus 3. Well, I should write y here for range. Okay. Minus 3, y, and 6. And the transformation is 5 and minus 1. We'll multiply by 5. So minus 3 times 5 and take away 1. So that becomes for g of y. Is it okay? 6 times 5. And then you're going to take away 1. Correct? So minus 15, you get minus 16 here for g of y. And I should write only g of x actually, not y. Let's change this. So it is gx. That is the y value, correct? And that is 5 times 6 is 30, 29. Take away 1. So that becomes the range. So what we are doing here is we are applying the transformations directly to the function. Perfect. Now let's move on to take the next test question, which is question number 14. Question is, sketch graph of a relation that is not a function, and whose domain is this and range is that. Okay, so domain is less than 5 and range is between 3 and 5. You have to sketch this particular function, right? So we are talking about the domain, the x value, which should be on this side. And as far as the y values are concerned, we want them between 3 and 5. So let's say this is like this, 3 and 5. Does it make sense? So that becomes the area where you should be sketching your function. So what could it be? Right? That is what you know. Perfect. So you could sketch any function kind of like this. If I write a straight line here, right, and go kind of like this and like this, that makes sense. Where this point here is 5 and this point is 3. So that should satisfy the conditions given to us. So that is how you could think and provide your solutions. However, solutions will vary. Now, these are the last 5 questions for you, or rather 6. So I will leave them for you to do. I'd like you to pause the video, copy these questions, and try them out. Now, these are very important word problems. I'll take up part 3, in which we'll combine these problems with advanced level domain and range. We'll also take trigonometric functions and exponential and logarithmic functions. Okay, so that should help. Here is the last page with 4 questions. I'd like you to copy these 4 questions also and think about their solutions, right? Let this be an assignment for you. So the assignment is from question 15 to question 20. Perfect. So in part 3, we'll consider a solution of these questions, and then we'll actually take up another part. We'll call that at part 4 for trigonometric functions. Exponential functions, logarithmic, and composite functions, right? So that'll be very interesting. So domain and range is a huge topic. It has been taught in high school up to grade 12, and I hope these concepts will really help you. What we have covered in part 1 and 2 is good enough for MCR3U. So if you are doing MCR3U, we have completed everything you need to know. Now in part 3 and 4, we'll talk more about what you learn in MHF4U. So I hope that makes sense. Feel free to write your comment, share your views, and if you like and subscribe to my videos, that'd be great. Thanks for your time and all the best.